everyone. I'm Reid Musngi. It is 9 a.m. in Manila, 10 a.m. in Tokyo, and 11 a.m. in Sydney. The headlines. U.S. President Joe Biden again downplaying recession fears even after the U.S. economy contracted for a second straight quarter. Wall Street rallies as investors speculate the weak U.S. GDP print would force the Federal Reserve to be more dovish moving forward. Asian shares set to mirror gains. Here at home, the PSE index kicks off from 63.79, jumping more than 2% after the Fed's rate hike. Corina Gravia of Regina Capital joins us for Market Outlook. And the Philippine province of Abra, now under a state of calamity following Wednesday's strong quake. We begin in the U.S., where President Joe Biden is trying to soothe worries about the strength of the world's largest economy. He's highlighting several positive points, saying companies are still hiring, unemployment is at 50-year lows, and manufacturers are still investing. That's after the U.S. economy contracted 0.9% in the second quarter, after shrinking 1.6% in the first 3 months of the year. Consumer spending was the biggest drag, growing at its slowest pace in 2 years. But for Biden, the slowdown is not a surprise as the Federal Reserve acts to bring down inflation.
There's going to be a lot of chatter today on Wall Street and among pundits about whether we are in a recession. But if you look at our job market, consumer spending, business investment, we see signs of economic progress in the second quarter as well. Expect growth to be slower than last year and the rapid clip we had. But that's consistent with the transition to a stable, steady growth and lower inflation.
The two straight quarters of contraction further fanned fears the U.S. could be entering a recession or one had already begun. But America's Treasury chief downplays those concerns.
Most economists and most Americans have a similar definition of recession: substantial job losses and mass layoffs, businesses shutting down, private sector activities slowing considerably, family budgets under immense strain, in sum, a broad-based weakening of our economy. That is not what we're seeing right now. When you look at the economy, we simply haven't seen anything like this since the 1970s, and seeing what's happening to food prices and energy prices, the president's top priority to bring inflation down.
A look now at financial markets. Wall Street rallied for a second straight day Thursday as investors speculate slowing growth in the U.S. may deter the U.S. Federal Reserve from continuing its aggressive rate hikes. All the major indices added 1%, with the Dow jumping over 300 points. Wall Street is on track for a winning week and its best month for 2022. On the earnings front, Apple reported fiscal third quarter earnings beating Wall Street expectations for sales and profit and projecting faster sales growing ahead, or rather growth ahead. Apple's revenue hit $83 billion. Apple shares rose over 3% in extended trading. Meanwhile, Amazon shares climbed more than 13% after the company reported better than expected second quarter revenue and gave an optimistic outlook. It says it expects a jump in third quarter revenue as the retailer collects bigger fees from Prime loyalty subscriptions and as consumer demand rises. Taking a look now at U.S. stock futures, all major indices point to a higher open, with a tech-heavy Nasdaq set to lead gains when trading resumes tonight, Manila time. Over here in Asia, markets are also on the rise on cooling Fed rate hike bets. So far, Australia's ASX 200 is leading gains, up over 1% in early trade. South Korea's Kospi Index advancing 0.8%, while Japan's Nikkei 225 is up 0.4%. Meanwhile, markets in Thailand are closed for a holiday. Back here at home, President Marcos vetoes a bill seeking to expand the franchise area of Aboitiz-owned Davao Light and Power Company, or DLPC. Marcos said he vetoed the measure since it may infringe on the franchise coverage area of the North Electric Cooperative, or NDEC. The bill sought to amend DLPC's 25-year franchise to construct, operate, and maintain a power system in Davao City and in other towns in Davao del Norte. But Marcos said NDEC still has existing franchises in the proposed coverage areas in the bill until 2033. He adds, allowing another power firm in those areas would also be against the Electric Power Industry Reform Act, which states that all existing franchises shall be allowed their full term. Now, here are some economic data releases we're monitoring this Friday. Vietnam will post its July inflation report. Consumer prices in Vietnam increased to a near two-year high of 3.37% in June, mainly boosted by faster rises in the cost of food and transport. Germany will come out with its July jobs print. The unemployment rate in Germany jumped to a seven-month high of 5.3% in June, prompted by Ukrainian refugees registering with the labor office in search of work. And the euro area will announce its second quarter GDP numbers. The eurozone's economy expanded by 5.4% in the first 3 months of 2022, the biggest annual gain in three quarters, as household spending grew faster while growth remained robust for public spending. A state of calamity declared in the Philippine province of Abra, the epicenter of a deadly earthquake that rocked Luzon Island Wednesday. President Marcos visited Abra and ordered concerned agencies to immediately restore water supply in the area. More from Pia Gutierrez.
A day after a powerful magnitude 7 quake hit Luzon, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. flew to the epicenter Abra to see for himself the situation in the quake-hit province. Once there, Marcos Jr. presided over a situation briefing with local and national officials in the capital, Benguet, where he was updated on the government's rescue and relief efforts. Among the first questions of the president, is it already safe for residents to return to their homes?
Yusek Solidum, are we allowing them already? Are we allowing them already to go back into their homes, to at least the engineers, to inspect if they are safe?
Yes po. So, kung declared talagang structurally safe po yung mga building, pwede na. But people should be ready how to respond properly during aftershocks. Kasi malakas pa po ang posibleng aftershock.
Abra has declared a state of emergency, and according to reports, almost 5,000 families or 20,000 individuals in 110 villages in the Ilocos and Cordillera regions have been affected by the quake. Over 2,300 families are still staying at evacuation centers. During the meeting, the president ordered agencies to immediately work on restoring the supply of clean water. The Office of Civil Defense says the entire province of Abra needs some 300,000 bottles of drinking water. Marcos Jr. also called on agencies to expedite the clearing of damaged roads and bridges, as well as to prioritize the safety inspections of hospitals and medical facilities so these can be used immediately.
National government agencies, lahat ng gagawin ninyo, please coordinate closely with the local government para ma-maximize ang inyong mga asset. Hindi kayo nag-uulit, hindi kayo nagkukulang. You plan everything together. You listen to the local governments kasi sila ang they are the ones who have the fundamental responsibility to bring this aid to our people.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. meanwhile agrees with his sister Senator Aimee Marcos that further strengthening the National Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Council would be enough for government to effectively respond to calamities and disasters without the need to create a separate agency.
May I recommend, rather than a full-scale department na mauubos lang ang budget sa sahod ng 5 USEC, sangkatutak na ASEC, can we start by an NDRRMC authority or administration tulad ni Apo Lakay, yung DBM nag-umpisa bilang commission?
We are siblings indeed. I fully agree. I did not ever understand the concept of a full ministry of full department. I don't think it means that
because you don't really have to form policy. It is just an implementation of a rescue mission or search and rescue mission.
The president says a good model to follow would be that of the United States Federal Emergency Management Agency, or FEMA, which is an agency under the U.S. Department of Homeland Security.
In our case, perhaps just to prove the point, is simply to put it under the office of the president so that the orders can be issued to different departments because they're primo inter pares, right? So perhaps the best would be that situation under the office of the president, not a mere authority or administration, so that we save on cost.
But on Wednesday, President Marcos Jr. in a briefing said that he supports the passage of a measure creating the Department of Disaster Resilience, as he noted the need for a specialist agency to mitigate disasters brought about by climate change. Meanwhile, in a separate briefing, the DSWD said that residents affected by the powerful earthquake may avail of financial assistance between 5,000 to 10,000 pesos under the Assistance to Individuals in Crisis Situation. Families of quake fatalities will also receive burial assistance from the government amounting to 25,000 pesos. Pia Gutierrez, ABS-CBN News.
Over 2,300 families from affected provinces are still staying at evacuation centers. They are afraid of going back to their homes amid the lingering threat of aftershocks. As of Thursday afternoon, FEVOX has recorded more than 800 aftershocks. Experts warn it will continue for weeks.
Ay, alaka, sir, hindi kami nakatulog buong magdamag.
So, anong gagawin niyo dito sa bahay niyo?
Ala na, totally na yan, sir. Talagang hindi na pwedeng tiran dyan. Hindi na pwede.
Getting fuel is also a major struggle in Abra.
Tapon pa, wa. Yun, ang dami naman nasakay, yun lang, kukunti ang nagdibiyahe kasi walang gasolina. Mga ibang gasolinahan, hindi nagabukas.
Philippine authorities reopen more quake hit roads in the Cordillera Administrative Region. The Public Works Department declared these three roads passable to traffic. So far, 17 out of 21 road sections affected by Wednesday's tremor have now been reopened. Public Works Secretary Manuel Bonoan says President Marcos has ordered his agency to work double time to reopen the remaining closed roads. Over 8,000 schools were affected by Wednesday's quake in Luzon. 164 were damaged. That's based on the assessment of the Philippine Disaster Management Agency. The Education Department says it would cost 940 million pesos to reconstruct and rehabilitate these damaged schools. DepEd has called for an emergency meeting with the regional and division disaster officials of the affected regions so they can coordinate their response. It's also looking into the number of affected students, teachers, and non-teaching personnel so they can decide whether it will postpone the opening of school next month.
Wala pa pong desisyon or anunsyo sa pagpapa-delay ng start ng classes para po dyan sa mga apektado ng ating lindol kahapon. Although we are continuously monitoring po yung situation sa field.
Now, according to UNESCO, the Philippines has more than 22,000 students currently studying abroad. The Philippine Commission on Higher Education also predicts this number to grow even more in the coming years. But there are also a lot of challenges hindering Filipino students from venturing out, like the lack of funds. For more on this, we are joined by Birch Ian Ranes, the Managing Director of Phil Global Immigration Services Corporation. Ian, good morning and grateful you could join us.
Thank you for having us here, Rain. Good morning.
Can you share with us where Filipino students usually go for studies abroad and why those countries?
Yeah, so for our company, sends most of our students to Canada, Australia, and United States. And it's because of the affordability of the programs. And our company provides fly now, pay later options for these young kids to study and work and live abroad.
Mm-hmm. Does the Philippines have a clear policy goals to enhance outbound international student mobility?
At the moment, the most of the policies in the Philippines are really focused with overseas Filipino workers. There's no regulation yet with the student visas in the country. Our company is gearing towards helping young Filipinos aim towards affordability para makapag-aral sila sa ibang bansa. So hopefully there'll be more policies to protect the interests of young Filipinos, because there's a lot of scams in the Philippines. And our advocacy here as the only ISO-certified company in the Philippines to protect these young Filipinos na maiwasan sana silang maloko and sana ay magbago yung buhay nila sa ibang bansa. And hopefully, come back to the Philippines to give more jobs to our common Filipino men.
That's right. Talking about the scams, we'll get back to that in a moment. But may we know, what are the ways some of these bright students from less privileged families, how do they have the opportunity to study abroad?
All right. So number one, I advise them to do a lot of research first. And second, it's search for the most legitimate agencies by logging into more of the reviews as to whether the companies are actually providing the right services for these young Filipinos. And number three, of course, check on the background and the profile. Make sure that the advice is good for you. Like if you're a nurse, pwede ka pang maging caregiver or maging registered nurse sa ibang bansa. And get the right assessment by talking to consultants such as our company, Philgopan.
Is there a resource or an agency or a tool that helps students make sure that these are legit agencies or legit resources that they can tap so that they can get these scholarships or be able to access education abroad?
One of the things that would probably help this student is to check whether they have ISO certification. Some of these companies in the Philippines don't have that yet. At the moment in the Philippines, the way that you can check agencies by logging to their reviews, but at the moment it's not really regulated, but other countries regulate student visas already. But I think where the government can come in and probably start regulating student visas to avoid all these new startup agencies from scamming young students.
Mm-hmm. Ian, do we know which courses, perhaps what kind of skills or what kind of training these students are going for? What are the most in demand?
We have now K-12 programs, and the most in demand are well for caregiver. It's a personal support worker. They can fly to Canada and Australia. And for Australia, it's a best advantage today because all the students can work full-time at the moment. So mind you, the students are earning money up to 200, 300,000 pesos for this because they can work 40, 60 hours per week. Because some of the countries that you go for working visas are only giving you like 30,000 pesos average salary. Sometimes they don't have even day offs. But in Australia, you could have that 5 days a week work and 2 days study only. So at least you can study and work at the same time. And, you know, they have the capacity to pay for their tuition fees because at least they have jobs there. Mm-hmm.
So you're saying that these courses, they go there not just to study, but to work at the same time. But is there an opportunity for them to actually file for citizenship while they're doing their education and work experience abroad?
Correct, yes. So all our programs that we're offering are actually the shortage occupation list, which guarantees that the candidates can apply for citizenship in a maximum of like 5 years' time of studying and working there abroad.
Is there a target number of students that you're trying to go for? Is there a target as to how many students we should be taking there, or how many students Australia, countries like Australia and Canada are looking for, just to be able to fill in, you know, their schools as well as, you know, their training facilities?
Our company at the moment is targeting 100,000 Filipinos by next year. We're offering the fly now pay later option, wherein we can help more Filipinos get into that country by paying at least around 100,000 to 200,000 pesos only. So if the candidates are really qualified, our company can assist them, making sure that we have the affordability in mind and also making sure that maging globally competitive din sila. And eventually when they come back to the country as a chef or as a nurse or as a doctor, that they can help most of the Filipino citizens with setting up businesses as well.
Can you share with us what has been the trend so far? Are there more and more Filipinos getting an education abroad, or has it been declining in recent years? We would understand if that was the case because of the recent pandemic affecting us for the last 2 years.
As a student myself 10 years ago, I went to London to study abroad as well. I see that there's more trend right now. In our company, there are 100%. Actually, we doubled in numbers as well with sending students abroad. We see that there are also entrepreneurs here in the country when during the lockdowns and the closing of businesses, more entrepreneurs are actually considering to have dual citizenship. And the fastest way to fly is through PhilGlobal because we can process the visas in 3 months. So if you're planning to fly abroad now, the next intake will be in January. And we see that more students are actually flying because of the opportunities to work at the same time. And of course, leveling up your skills to advance your career.
Now, once there, supposing that they encounter any untoward incidents or they actually instigate some untoward incidents, what kind of protections can we offer our Filipino students or workers abroad? Of course, it's different for the POEA and, DOLE, but what about on your end? Is there anything that they can, that students can depend on with the agencies?
Yes, as an ISO certified company, we are the only agency that provides lifetime membership to our clients, making sure that from visa application, upon arrival, somebody picks them up, assisting them with jobs as well, helping them bring their families and their spouses and their kids, most importantly, because we are towards family reunification. And towards their working visa, we assist them. And the only time that we stop servicing our members is when they become citizens of Canada, Australia, US. And of course, we still assist them if they want to come back to the Philippines and eventually set up their own businesses.
Would you say that immigration consultancy firms like yours have significantly contributed to the economy of the Philippines? Especially after these students graduate, they're working, maybe some of them come back to the Philippines?
I should say yes. As they are earning and studying abroad, they're also sending money to the Philippines in dollar revenues as well. So I should say that most of the agencies here, considering that they're helping Filipinos as well, have contributed to the economy of the country.
All right, Birch Ian Ranis of PhilGlobal Immigration Services Corporation. Thank you so much for sharing your insights with us. We appreciate it.
Thank you so much. Good morning.
Up next, a look at the opening numbers of the Philippine Stock Exchange with Corinne Agravia of Regina Capital. Market Edge will be right back. Stay with us. You're still watching Market Edge. Here's another look at the headlines. U.S. President Joe Biden again downplaying recession fears even after the U.S. economy contracted for a second straight quarter. Wall Street rallies as investors speculate the weak U.S. GDP print would force the Federal Reserve to be more dovish moving forward. Asian shares also climbing at the open. Here at home, the PSE index kicks off from 63.79, jumping more than 2% after the Fed's rate hike. Corinne Agravia of Regina Capital joins us for a market outlook. And the Philippine province of Abra now under a state of calamity following Wednesday's strong quake. And the Philippine Stock Exchange kicks off trading at 63.79. Joining us today for a take on the market, Corinne Agravia of Regina Capital. Corinne, good morning and good to see you again.
Good morning. Thank you for having me back.
So it looks like it's going to be a winning week for the markets. The number to beat is 62.63. If we beat that, this week is going to be the third positive week for July. What are the most important charts in the market today?
Well, you know, of course, we first have to look at the chart of the PSEI. And if we check yesterday's charts, actually, we're going to see that the index gapped up significantly. And that could mean that the momentum could translate into some leftover rallies for this week, you know, to close in the green for the third straight week in July. So while a continuation today is possible, we always do still have to remember that gap ups like yesterday are very, very volatile. And the common assumption for these patterns is that if something gaps up, sooner or later, the prices will correct in order to fill that gap. So investors have to remember that in the case of the PSEI, this would imply that while a rally continuation later today is possible, technically speaking, there will always be a correction or a pullback looming that, you know, could push the index to significant lows in order for it to fill the previous gap and that it missed out, you know. So it needs to form a solid consolidation base first before it actually sustains a rally. And with that said, I think investors are, you know, should monitor when will that filling of that gap happen. At this point, we don't know yet, and we're still not too sure yet. So the best thing to do is, you know, ride the rally and be cautious in positioning. Of course, know when to take profits or know when to top slice. So that's the first chart that we're looking at. Of course, the BSEI, that's very important. There's also we're also monitoring the net foreign activity versus the performance of the PSEI. So, you know, investors should also closely monitor where the hot money is going, if it's going inside the Philippines or going outside of the market. So far for the month, we've been net foreign selling for worth 6.5 billion pesos. And if we backtrack, there is a very strong correlation between net foreign activity and the performance of the PSEI. So, for example, the index was down almost 1.5% last July 13. If you check the charts, that was almost 100 points down. And during that certain trading session, there was net foreign selling worth 707 million. And for reference, you know, to compare, the average daily net foreign selling for the year for 2022 is just 300 million. So that's something significant. And, you know, I'm just stating separate occasions, but we've backtracked and we've done numbers, and there is a somewhat significant correlation between net foreign activity and the performance of the index. So that's always something that investors should monitor. It would be a helpful metric too to gauge the overall sentiment of the market at the moment. It kind of helps investors decide when to buy or sell.
Corinne, of course, value turnover has also been pretty slim in the past few weeks, way below the 6 to 7 billion pesos that we're used to. But looking at the technicals, those are the technicals that you mentioned, but are they aligned with the fundamentals? Is there anything in the fundamentals of a PSEI, of the companies, the listed companies, that tell you that our trend will likely be on the way up or on the way down?
That's actually a pretty funny thing. There's actually a pretty funny thing going on right now, since the movement of the technicals and the fundamentals are contrarian at this point. Since the foreign think tanks, everyone else outside of the Philippines believes that the Philippines will outperform our Southeast Asian neighbors in terms of economic growth. So you have Fitch, you have Moody's, all those big foreign think tanks upgrading our GDP growth for 2022 and downgrading most or the rest of the other countries, even downgrading the projections for the global economy for 2022. So, you know, everyone's pretty much expecting fundamental-wise that the Philippines is going to grow significantly, it's going to post strong growth for 2022, but that's not translating into actual upward movement for the index. So it's quite contrarian at this point. If we base it on the technicals, we're at a discount right now. So if everyone's just going to follow the technicals, that should mean that everyone should start buying now, since it's a good opportunity to position. We're at a discount, we're below market weight. So it's a bit contrarian. So that's the technicals and the fundamentals. They're going both separate ways at the moment. So it's pretty hard to tell when they're going to meet in the future.
All right, Corinne, let's take a look at some of the updates. We have, of course, the Fed rate hike, the technical recession in the U.S. We also have chatter of a looming housing crisis in the U.S., as has been seen in China. You have looming call between President Biden and Chinese President Xi Jinping. Plus, of course, Jack Ma is planning to give up control of Ant, according to reports. Are all these developments between the U.S. and China expected to have an effect on the Philippine markets?
Well, you know, there's always, it's a point of, it's the question right now becomes whether or not the relationships between U.S. and China are stable. Developing countries like us, the impact on developing countries like the Philippines or third world countries like the Philippines, it has a lagging effect. So right now, I don't expect that big of an impact, at least, or that substantial of an impact on the local markets. Since, of course, the local economy is still doing well, no matter what's happening with the U.S. and China so far. So there's not going to be an immediate impact.
Our monetary board still meeting in the middle of August. That's still a few days away, still at least half a month away. Are you expecting an off-cycle rate hike from the Philippine Central Bank?
Well, given that they already did an off-cycle rate hike a few weeks ago, there's likely not going to be another one yet. And they already did say that they're going to hike rates in the next policy monetary board meeting. So no off-cycle rate hikes as of the moment. And we're kind of in limbo right now, you know, with the Fed hiking rates just a few days ago and us still 3 weeks away from the next monetary policy board meeting. So the peso still has a bit of room to depreciate, you know, given the all else constant, very strong dollar.
Where do you see what's your outlook for the Philippine peso in the coming weeks or up to the end of the year?
Well, yeah, like I said, in the coming weeks, there could be further room for depreciation. If we just look at the charts, actually, the peso, technicals-wise, the peso has found a support at 55.30, and this looks like a solid enough base that could prompt consolidation. If we translate this to fundamentals, that this would imply that a stronger peso isn't in the works, at least for the next few weeks, or at least until the next policy meeting, or at least until the BSP hikes rates once again. And what would that imply? Generally, a weaker peso has always been inversely correlated with the equities market. So this could mean that, you know, there could be further downward pressures on an already battered stock market. And we've more or less 3 weeks until the next meeting. So we're kind of, again, in limbo here. So there's a bit of room for further depreciation.
Mm-hmm. Well, Corinne, let's take a look at the opening numbers of the Philippine Stock Exchange really quick. The PSEI opening lower by 0.6% to 63.37. Most counters also lower, except for mining and oil, which is higher by 0.5%. Now, taking a look at some of the corporate disclosures, Philippine 7 doubles its capex to 2 billion pesos this year to open 300 additional stores with a focus on residential areas. We also have Mega World expecting to generate 2.8 billion pesos in sales from its third residential project in Capital Town, Pampanga, and Montrose Park View to be completed by 2027. The Philippines also launches the renewable energy market to trade renewable energy certificates, and Colliers expects rising rates to clip demand for residential condos. On top of that, we also have CEMEX reporting a net loss. Let's take a look at that story right now. 267 million in the first half of 2022. with a net loss of $528 million recorded during the second quarter, mainly as a result of foreign exchange losses, higher income tax expenses, and lower operating EBITDA. But also, CHP's domestic cement volume decreased by 8% for the first 6 months of 2022. First of all, do you anticipate that CEMEX and construction-related activities will continue to see some weakness in the coming months?
Well, I think it's a different story for CEMEX and it's a different story for construction activity of the Philippines as a whole, since everyone pretty much expects that for the rest of the year, you know, with the reopening economy and the improving conditions that we're in right now, construction activity will continue to improve for the rest of the year, at least on a sequential basis. And of course, you have favorable base effects from last year. So construction activity-wise, we're going to see some improvement. However, it's a different story for CEMEX as a whole, since there's quite a bit of pressure on margins, considering, you know, prices of raw materials are still skyrocketing, and then you have higher logistic costs. So there's a bit of pressure on their operating margins. So while construction activity could improve, that would not directly translate into positive growth for CEMEX in general. But, you know, of course, prudent cost management would be able to help, you know, pad the numbers somewhat towards the end of the year for CEMEX.
Mm-hmm. What about the other stories? Do you expect any of them to move the markets today, from Philippine 7, Mega World, the renewable energy market, as well as rising rates clipping demand for residential properties?
I think a lot of investors are actually monitoring, you know, rising rates in relation to the property market. If we check the index heavyweights, the property names, the big property names, you have Ayala Land, you have SM Prime, they've been pretty volatile. Their average share price volatility has been significantly high compared to the index as a whole. So a lot of investors are monitoring whatever is happening with the property market. And, you know, other investors are, with the rising rates, there is lower demand for the residential. So others are betting on, for example, SM Prime, since it is a big mall, it's the biggest mall operator in the Philippines. So while the residential segment is relatively weak, you have the retail segment, the leasing segment, the commercial segment. All of those are still improving given the reopening economy and improving mobility numbers towards the end of the year. So investors are, you know, kind of weighing the pros and cons between residential and commercial. And I guess based on the recent share price performance, betting on reopening plays right now instead of the property developers.
Mm-hmm. And last but not the least, do you expect Aboitiz-linked firms to move, with President Marcos vetoing a bill seeking to expand the franchise area of Aboitiz-owned Davao Light and Power Company, or DLPC?
Well, there could be a knee-jerk selling reaction, since the market is generally very responsive to news updates like that. But there likely won't be any long-term impact on the share price of Aboitiz Power, since all else constant, Aboitiz still has very strong fundamentals. So that's what investors will likely take into account right now, especially for those, you know, going long on the stock. In fact, I think it only recently reported its earnings for the second quarter, which were above consensus estimates. So if anything, that's an indication that while the franchise was vetoed, it would not dent the firm's profitability, at least at the moment. And that's what investors should take into consideration while digesting that recent news.
All right, great guidance to start off the trades for the day. Corina Gravia of Regina Capital, pleasure to have you. Thank you so much for joining us today. We appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, U.S. House lawmakers passed a long-awaited bill subsidizing America's semiconductor industry as it competes with Chinese and other foreign manufacturers. 24 Republicans joined 218 Democrats in backing the sweeping legislation. It will now be sent to the White House, where President Joe Biden is expected to sign it into law early next week. The measure provides $52 billion in government subsidies for U.S. production of semiconductors used in everything from automobiles to high-tech weaponry to electric devices and video games. It includes an investment tax credit for chip plants, estimated to be worth $24 billion. The legislation also provides for $200 billion in over 10 years to boost U.S. scientific research. China had lobbied against a semiconductor bill, saying it was reminiscent of a Cold War mentality and counter to the common aspiration of people in both countries.
Massively growing market for chips. You know, just like America wants to produce chips, the Chinese market for chips required in electric vehicles, in electronics, is booming. So there is a need for American-designed chips to be placed in these items, which are then sold in China. What the US is trying to do is, at the most sophisticated level of chip production, create a certain degree of decoupling there so that that technology doesn't seep into at the Chinese end and China becomes a dominant or a strong player out there. So we have to understand, yes, a new chapter is being written, but fundamentally there's tremendous interdependence, and the US companies will themselves say that China is the fastest growing market, and no matter what you do with regard to chip production here, do not hamstring us from that interdependence, because that benefits us from a revenue perspective.
Well, Chinese President Xi Jinping issues the U.S. another warning over Taiwan during his latest phone call with American counterpart Joe Biden. Chinese state media says Xi told Biden, "Those who play with fire will eventually get burned." Biden, meanwhile, reassured Xi U.S. policy regarding Taiwan remains unchanged. Tensions around Taiwan are steadily escalating amid fears Xi could ultimately order an invasion of self-ruled island, which China considers part of its territory. The White House says the aim of the phone call was to steady the rocky relationship of the two superpowers. Both leaders also agreed to schedule what would be the first in-person summit since Biden took office. No details were given on the timing or location of that summit. Meanwhile, the Philippine government sees progress in negotiations for a code of conduct in the South China Sea aimed at easing tensions in the region. The Department of Foreign Affairs says stakeholders are now working on the general provisions. Assistant Secretary Daniel Espiritu says there is still no decision yet on whether the code of conduct will be legally binding, but the country wants Manila's arbitral win as part of the COC.
The Hague ruling is based on UNCLOS, and definitely UNCLOS will be a basis of the COC. Let me stress this. We are asserting the Hague ruling. But whatever is it that's on the Hague ruling are only reflections of specific provisions in UNCLOS. So whether we invoke the arbitral tribunal award or not, the point is the moment we use UNCLOS in the COC, in the negotiations of the COC, and its resultant mechanisms, I guess that will already be enough. In fact, UNCLOS is bigger than the arbitral award.
China claims almost all of the resource-rich region, but several countries, including the Philippines, have overlapping claims. Active COVID-19 cases in the Philippines near 30,000. That's after the Health Department reported 3,858 new infections on Thursday, the highest daily tally in over 5 months or since February 10. Of the additional cases reported during the day, more than 1,000 were from Metro Manila. The DOH confirms the capital region is now at moderate risk for COVID-19, but it insists the entire country is still classified as low risk. Meanwhile, 900 more cases of highly transmissible Omicron subvariants have been detected. The BA.5 again made up the majority at 890. The DOH notes that subvariant was found in all regions except Bangsamoro and Sokskarjen. The Chinese city of Wuhan mandates a lockdown in one of its districts following the detection of four asymptomatic cases. Almost a million people in Jingxia has been ordered to stay inside their homes for 3 days. This is the first time the city has imposed a shutdown since January 2020, after the virus was first found. Lockdowns and stringent restrictions have remained in place in China, which has continually maintained its zero COVID strategy. And time now to zip through the top headlines from major business papers. From Business World, Fitch Ratings says a significant slowdown in China's economic growth will likely hurt the sovereign ratings of Asia-Pacific economies, including the Philippines. From Business Mirror, the Agri-Agra Reform Credit Act of 2009, which provides better loan access to farmers, lapses into law. And from the Wall Street Journal, JetBlue Airways agrees to buy Spirit Airlines for $3.8 billion, a deal that would create the fifth largest U.S. carrier. And switching gears now, a lawyer and triathlete from the Philippines called the Pinoy Aquaman makes another feat as he completed a 5-kilometer open water swim in Lake Michigan in the U.S. Connie Makatula de Leon tells us more.
46-year-old triathlete Ingemar Macarine has done it again. The Bohol-based Macarine completed a full open water swim in Lake Michigan last Sunday, an event organized by iSwim for veterans. Despite Lake Michigan's reputation as one of the world's most dangerous lakes, this Pinoy Aquaman completed the swim in 2 hours and 57 minutes, covering a distance of more than 3 miles.
Yung waves lang talaga kanina, medyo malalaki talaga. Although, I encountered big waves before, pero kanina, salubong eh. Kaya, medyo mahirap. We have to shorten it by half. So instead of 10 kilometers, we have to shorten it by 5 kilometers because of bad weather.
Macarine, who is a public prosecutor by profession, says that his open swim journey that started a decade ago came from his desire to make a difference in himself and in the community.
I'm promoting marine conservation in the Philippines and also healthy lifestyle. Zero alcohol for 5 years already, and I'm a vegetarian. And of course, I sleep 8 hours a day. And I exercise every day.
As an endurance swimmer, Macarine has completed 36 open water swim events, including swimming from the Alcatraz Island to San Francisco, swimming across Chesapeake Bay in Maryland, Hudson River in New York, Lake Lane in Florida, and Golden Gate Bridge in California. Phil Amrey Letada, the organizer of the event and founder of iSwim for Veterans, says his goal is to help families, especially those who have lost loved ones.
We've lost quite a few of our men during the combat operations. So in the process, there were family members that were really hard up financially. So I thought about creating an organization, something like this.
Macarena says people should not be discouraged by setbacks, but rather let their experiences be their guiding light as they push for success.
My dream is to really swim the English Channel. I have already tried twice, but I failed. Those failures motivates me to swim again, probably 2 or 3 years from now.
As he flies back to the Philippines, Macarena says he will continue to train for more open water swims in Leyte and in Masbate.
Mabuhay ang Pilipinas!
Connie Macatula de Leon, ABS-CBN News, Chicago.
And before we go, stay informed and up to date with the latest news. Watch for free on iWantTFC. You may download the app or visit www.iwanttfc.com. And that is it for the show. I'm Rain Musngi. Thank you so much for watching. You can listen to our interviews again on the ANC Market Edge podcast, available on Spotify. You can also watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Stay safe and stay with ANC.
And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health